Yes, very good morning students. Today we'll be dealing with a new topic, that is a judgment and its various kinds. Now yesterday, 2 to 3 days prior to yesterday, from last 2 to 3 days, we are dealing with the topic decree, and I hope you all have understood the term decree. While dealing with the term decree, we have also discussed little bit about judgment. We have also discussed little bit about orders. We have also discussed that the judgment order is different from that of the decree. Now, before going in detail, or before actually understanding the difference between decree, judgment, and its various kinds, it is very important for us to understand what do we mean by the judgment and what are its various kinds. So student, the judgment definition has been provided under section 2 subclause 9. If we take into consideration the judgment which has been provided under section 2 subclause 9, we would see that judgment means the statement given by the judge on the ground of a decree or order. Judgment means the statement given by the judge on the ground of a decree or order. What does it say? That there is a decree, there is an order, and the grounds on which the decree or the order has been pronounced by the court, those grounds being written down in the judgment. So judgment is a rough work actually done by the court, which consists of n number of statements. These statements may contain the pleadings of the parties. This statement further inclusive of the issues framed by the court in order to narrow down the conflicting areas between the parties, and also the reasons behind ascertaining any fact or accepting or rejecting any kind of argument of the party, the statements thus made by the court while dealing the matter judicially. Though judgments are nothing but a judicial findings, so all those work being done in the form of a judicial finding is nothing but a judgment, and hence judgment means the statement which is given by the judge on the ground of decree or the order. From here also, students, we come to know that judgment is different, decree is different, and order is different. Now let us see what else is given so far as the judgment is concerned. Judgment is a statement of judge in relation to the grounds or reason of the basis on which an order is passed and decree is drawn. That is to say, judgment is nothing but a statement of judge. This statement of judge is in relation to what? It is in relation to the ground or the reasons or the basis on the which, the ground on which the order is passed of or the decree is drawn, or the order is passed of decree is drawn. Then in that case it is called as a judgment. It may be called as a declaration of a judge intention, as what would be the final result in the suit, and this intention needs to be backed by the reason, and therefore judgment may be called as a declaration of a judge intention as the final result of the suit, which is based on somewhat concrete reasoning. It is a solemn transaction publicly recorded by the court. This judgment writing may also be considered to be a transaction, a sole transaction, which is publicly recorded by the court, and and is a conclusive proof of the fact that there was a litigation between same parties which got terminated in certain ways. So it is nothing but whenever a judgment is passed in any of the case, it is nothing but a proven fact that a litigation between two parties got terminated, and only after terminating the litigation between the parties, the judgment could be passed. So judgment inclusive of, there could not be any type of like a partly preliminary judgment and partly judgment. This could not be the situation so far as judgment is concerned. Judgment inclusive of all the pleadings. It contains all the pleadings made by the party, all the things argued by the party, on the basis of things pleaded and argued, the issues been framed with the help of the advocates and the parties and the judge, all three of them try to make the issues in the parties, issues in the matter, and the court with the help of this lawyers, with the help of the argument submitted by them, try to find out whether the party is in a position to establish that particular fact or not. And on the basis of establishment and non-establishment of the fact, the issue has been answered. And on the basis of that, the court even give a reason behind why he has asserted any issue to be established and why he has not asserted any issue to be established. And hence, it is nothing but a Solomon transaction publicly recorded by the court and is a conclusive proof of the fact that there was a litigation between the parties. One of the party have filed the suit, another party got a chance to contest the suit. Both the parties equally participated in the matter, and lastly the matter got terminated by the court making a statement in the form of a judgment to that particular case. Now, the judgment merely establishes the fact that there was a judgment, but it does not prove its correctness. Need not necessarily the judgment which has been given by the court is always a correct, because if it is not correct, then in that case, definitely whatever the decree been drawn on the basis of that particular judgment would be having a challenging aspect, and we would challenge the same in the form of appeal. So, judgment merely establishes the fact that there is a judgment, but it does not prove, or we cannot say that it will always be a correct judgment. There may be somewhat a lacuna or wrong findings in the judgment, which later on be challenged in the form of an appeal before the higher authority. Now, if we take into consideration the judgment definition, which we have studied under Section 2, Clause 9, we would find that there are certain requirements to be called any statement to be a judgment. So, all these statements of the court are not a judgment, but if we consider a statement to be a judgment, then in that case, certain things need to be necessarily there. First, it should have a concise statement of the case. As we said, the judgment inclusive of the pleadings of both the parties. That is to say, it should have a concise statement. In short, in brief, the court would write down, the court would jot down what the pleadings are made by the parties. So, it should have a concise statement of the case. Second one is the points for determination. This is nothing but a issues. So, point for determination means the area of conflict decided by the court. So, after hearing both the parties, whatever is being made, the statement made by the party and the other party denied the same. So, whatever the things been denied by the one of the party alleged the thing and the another denies the thing. Whatever is denied by the party become a conflicting area between the parties, and this conflicting areas, in other words, are called as a issue of law and issue of fact between the parties, and these issues need to be decided, need to be determined by the court, and for this purposes only both the parties are directed to file their pleadings. So, points for determination means the area of conflict between both the parties need to be actually decided by the court, and that it is must, the judgment must reflect that there is a particular area of conflict between the parties. Next is the decision of court on such issues. Now, after determining the points which need to be decided, which would lower down the area of conflict between the parties, so whatever the court has given a decision over that particular issues, the particular points, particular area of conflict between the parties. So whatever the decision the court has given it. And last is the reason for such decisions. So whenever we talk about the requirement of judgment is concerned, first it should have a concise statement of the case, that to say what both the parties says. Second, on the basis of their statement, what is the area of conflict between the parties, that is to say the point for determination. The third, the decision of the court on such issue. After framing the issues, the court would try to find out the solution for those issues, and whatever the solution which the court has given is called as the decision of the court on such issues, and the reasons behind coming to that particular decision, the reason for such decision would be considered to be an essential element for the purposes of considering any judgment to be a valid one. Now, if we take into consideration the binding nature of the judgment. What is the binding nature of the judgment? It is having a binding nature of It is binding over the parties. Definitely, whosoever is a party to the suit would be having a bind those party over those parties. There would be a binding judgment. Now, it must be obeyed by all the parties to the suit. Both the parties, they may be aggrieved, they may not be aggrieved, but whosoever is the party to the suit have to obey this particular judgment. Now, if the party do not exercise their right to appeal within the limitation period, or if no appeal is provided in law, the judgment attains finality and binding. Abhi, sometimes students, you have heard that whenever you take out any decision of the court, you'll find out that it is nothing but a judgment. There is no specifically simple word, last may there's a sentence and decree to be drawn accordingly. But the heading of that particular statement is judgment. Why it is so? Have you ever thought of in this direction? Now let us understand. Whenever a court decides a matter, then in that case, there may be an option wherein the person aggrieved by that particular decision may have a right in law to go in appeal. Right to go in appeal is a statutory right. Unless and until this right being given to the person, person do not have a right to appeal. In other words, we would say that all the decree cannot be appealed against. For considering any decree to be an appealable one, what is necessary? The law should provide that particular provision that a person aggrieved by such a decree would be having a right to go in appeal. Another one is, whenever it is provided that a person being aggrieved by a particular decree would be having a right to go in appeal, then in that case, during within which period one must go in appeal has been provided under Limitation Act. Suppose, for example, ke taur pe, if a person is aggrieved by the decree given by the lower court, then in that case, he would be having a right to appeal. If provided under the law, right to appeal, then in that case, he will be exercising that right to appeal within a period of 30 days, which has been provided under Law of Limitation Act 1963. But suppose if he is aggrieved by the decision of a district court, suppose, or if he is a civil jurisdiction district court, aggrieved by the decision, then in that case he'll be having a right to go in appeal in the high court within the period of 60 days. So from the lower court to the district court, it's 30 days, and from district court to the high court, it is 60 days. So in both the situation, the time period is different, right? So, if a person, suppose, fails to go in appeal within the time period provided under the Law of Limitation Act, then in that case, or even if he goes in appeal but he fails to establish his stand over there, then in that case, whatever the judgment which is given by the lower court would attain the finality and would be having a binding effect. So, if we take into consideration the binding nature of the judgment, we have to keep it in mind three important things. Firstly, it is a binding over the parties. Parties to say who won, who filed the matter, and the another who contests the matter. So, both the parties, plaintiff as well as the defendant, the judgment would be binding over these particular parties. It must be obeyed by all the parties to the suit. because the judgment is having a binding effect. These are the statements of the court, and these are the statements which are passed only by hearing both the parties, and hence it must be obeyed by the parties in the suit. Concern suit. Now, if the parties do not exercise their right to appeal, suppose if the party been given right to appeal, but the party do not go in appeal within that particular time period which has been prescribed under the Law of Limitation Act 1963, or if suppose no appeal is provided, the decree is such that, or the judgment is such that there is no provision of appeal against that particular judgment or against that particular decree or that particular order, then in that case, whatever the judgment given by the court would attend its finality, would be considered to be a final one and would be having a binding effect over the parties. Now, students, let us see what are the kinds of judgment. Now, judgment are of two types. Firstly, the judgment in personam and the judgment in rem. When we take into consideration judgment in personam, now what do we mean by the term personam? Personam means in person. Personam means in person. Rem means against whole world. Rem means whole world. So judgment in personam means whenever a judgment binds only parties to the suit. Such type of a judgment would be considered to be a judgment in personam. Suppose, for example, ke taur pe, I filed a suit against you, a suit in relation to tort, a suit in relation to contract, a suit in relation to crime. Why I am using these three words? For the reason, if suppose I enter into a contract with you, who is going to get a benefit? Either you or me or both of us are going to get a benefit out of that particular contract. No third person who is not a party to the contract is going to get a benefit out of this particular contract. So, whatever the judgment would be passed in this particular suit would only be limited to you and me. And hence, because this contract is limited to you and me only, hence whatever the judgment is passed in this particular contract would be considered to be a judgment in personam and would not be having a binding effect outside. Next is the tort. Tort is nothing but a civil wrong. If it is done to me, then in that case, I'll file a suit against you. Whatever the remedy in the form of injunction or a damage the court is going to give would be only giving to me. No anybody else apart from me would be entitled to have or a claim over that particular remedy or a damage. And hence, whatever the judgment is given to me, because tort is done in person, so whatever the wrong has been done to me, I file a suit against you. While contesting the suit, the court found that I am a person who is entitled to any particular right. Accordingly, I have been given a remedy for the same. So whatever the judgment the court has given would be considered to be a judgment in person. No any other third person would be entitled to have any kind of benefit out of that particular judgment. Similarly, when we talk about a crime, so even in respect to the crime, because it is done to an individual, crime is done to an individual, the judgment and the punishment under that particular judgment is only actually limited to that particular accused and would be considered to be conclusive proof in the subsequent proceedings between the parties if suppose it takes or it goes further in the higher courts. So the judgment is between parties in case of contract, tort or crime and are conclusive proof in subsequent proceedings between same parties or their primes, that is to say, or their representatives, and not against any stranger. But that is not the situation with judgment in rem. When it binds all men and not only the parties to the suit in which it was passed. Judgment in rem means what? It would be against the whole world. It would not particularly to be against a particular person only. Now let us understand suppose if smoking is banned in a public place, then in that case it would be judgment against whole world. It would be applied to all the people may be party to the suit or maybe again may be a stranger to the suit. So when such type of a judgment is passed in any of the matter, because if somebody would take an initiative, then only a suit in respect to that would be filed and the judgment would be given in that respect. But we have to see that whatever the judgment has been given is whether a judgment in personam or a judgment in rem. So whenever the judgment, though which may be passed in a particular matter, suppose for example the PIL, then in that case it would be available, the benefit of that particular judgment would be available to the strangers also. So when it binds all men and not only the parties to the suit which is against which it is passed or which are the actually parties to the suit, then in that case a step of a judgment is called as a judgment in rem. Now the judgment which are conclusive against the whole world. Here, judgment in personam were conclusive against the individual and judgment in rem are conclusive against the whole world. When judgment are conclusive against the whole world, such type of a judgment would be considered to be judgment in rem. Now, judgment are pronounced upon the status of subject matter and hence conclusive even against a stranger. When we take into consideration judgment in rem, one more point, it says that whatever the judgment are pronounced upon a status of subject matter. Status of subject matter, whatsoever is the subject matter of the suit, what is its status? And hence, if anything is said in the judgment in respect to the status of subject matter, then in that case we would say it is not limited to a person individual, it would be available, the benefit or the obligation whatsoever is arising out of that particular subject matter or in relation to that particular subject matter would be made available to the strangers also. Now let us have an example of judgment in personam and judgment in rem. If we take into consideration the examples of judgment in personam, so as we know, it is nothing but a judgment in relation to a person. It is only limited to a party to the suit. And the examples could be as if an order setting aside an ex parte decree, a written order deciding one or several issues, a diary note by a judge ordering final decree to be drawn up in mortgage suit. Now let us see one by one. When we talk about an order setting aside an ex parte decree means what? Whenever a person files a suit before the court, other party do not attend the suit, or a party against whom a suit has been filed do not attend the proceedings, then in that case, only on hearing one side, court decides the matter. When such type of order is passed, it is called as an ex parte decree. Whenever an ex parte decree is passed, there is a provision of setting aside that ex parte decree, provided the party applying for setting aside the ex parte decree must prove in the court that why this ex parte decree need to be set aside, because if this particular decree is not set aside, then in that case, my lord, I'll be put under irreparable loss. If we satisfy to the court that an ex parte decree need to be set aside, then only he'll be able to do the, he'll be able to get the justice, then in that case, only the court would set aside the ex parte decree. So this particular application or this particular order for setting aside the ex parte decree is in relation to a particular person only, and hence this would be considered to be a judgment in personam. Next is an written order deciding one or several issues. There are several issues in the matter and one of the issue been answered by the court. Suppose for example the issue is whether Anita madam has proved that she is the owner of a house. If the court answers it in the affirmative, then in that case definitely this particular statement would be having a binding effect over me, as well as I'll be considered to be the owner of that particular property. No else, no stranger would be considered to be having any kind of right over that particular property. So one of the issue, if being decided by the court and a written order being given by the court or issued by the court, then in that case, that to that particular aspect, it would be considered to be judgment in personam. Next one is the diary note by the judge ordering final decree to be drawn up in the mortgage suit. Now again a mortgage is a transaction between two particular person, the mortgager and the mortgagee. It has the entire world has nothing to do with this particular mortgage which has taken place between me and you. So whatever the final order or final decree passed by the court in this particular mortgage suit, then in that case it would be considered to be a judgment in persona. Suppose if I mortgage my property to you and I have a right to redeem my mortgage property. Right to redeem my mortgage property means what? After the making of payment of mortgage money, I have a right to reclaim my property back. But suppose if you refuse to give my property, then in that case, what remedy do I have? I have a remedy to go to court and get my property redeemed back. So for this purposes, I have to file a suit. Whenever I file a suit, whatever the judgment is passed by the court would only be in relation to my right over that particular property, because that subject matter of that particular suit belongs to exclusively me. And hence, whatever the diary note by the judge, made by the judge ordering final decree to be drawn up in a mortgage suit, all those diary note, all those statement would be considered to be a judgment in persona. Now students, let us see the examples of judgment in rem. The judgment deciding matrimonial status of the parties would be considered to be a judgment in rem. Next is final judgment of the court of insolvency jurisdiction declaring a party to be insolvent. Now, why declaring a party to be insolvent would be covered under the head of judgment in rem? The reason behind that is, suppose for example, ke taur pe, because we know that there is an insolvency law, and for insolvent we do have a particular definition. So whenever whosoever in India comes or is covered under the definition of insolvent would be having this particular provision applicable to him, and hence we would say that it is nothing but an example of judgment in rem. Next is Evidence Act 1882, specifically section 41 deals with the same thing. Now, judgment in rem is a final judgment, order or a decree of competent court in relation to probate proceedings, in relation to matrimonial proceedings, in relation to admiralty or insolvency jurisdiction. But when we take into consideration the judgment in persona, then in that case, where the judge stated that the suit was time barred and liable to be dismissed, it amount to a statement by a judge and therefore is a judgment. Because here, when the judge is saying in a suit that a suit is time barred, suit file karne ka jo time hai, wo khatm ho gaya hai, and isi wajah se I am dismissing it. Then in that case, he is conclusively determining the rights of the parties, saying that now you do not have any right to come in appeal or to file a fresh suit for the reason that you have already exercised your right by filing a matter, already a time been given to you. Suppose if you were aggrieved by the judgment given by the court, you would have gone in appeal, but because you have not exercised the right to appeal, now you do not have any of the right, and hence the party, the judgment which has been passed would be only limited in relation to that particular party, and therefore the statement issued by the court dismissing the particular suit saying that it is time barred would be considered to be a judgment in persona passed against that particular party who want to take the matter in further stage. Now, last point, if we take into consideration, the right in rem is an exception from the general rule. That is, judgment binds only the impleaded parties and not others, because we knew that whosoever is pleading in the matter would be getting a judgment. But judgment in rem is an exception to it, because there may be some time a judgment may be passed which is not only limited to a party but would be also benefiting or would be also obligating outside the also benefiting the people who are, though not made a party to the suit, but directly or indirectly are going to get effect or benefit by that particular judgment. So such type of a judgment is called as a judgment in rem. So, students, I hope you have understood the term judgment, you have understood the legal requirement which is necessary for considering any judgment to be a valid judgment, and we have also seen the various kinds and the difference among the judgment and judgment in persona and judgment in rem. So, now we'll proceed further, and the further definition which we would try to complete today is the definition of the term order. Because three of the words, the decree, judgment and order, are the relative one, and there's always a question in the question paper that find out the difference between decree, judgment and order. It is necessary for us to understand what we mean by the term order, though there are many other definitions which been left in between, but because they were not in relation to each other directly, and hence they were never been asked collectively, and therefore we have considered only those definitions which been asked collectively, that is to say decree, judgment and order. Now let us see what has been what do we mean by the term order. Students, order term has been defined under section 2 sub clause 14. It is having one or the same aspects which the decree was having, but there is a little bit of difference in decree and order. Now student, let us see what do we mean by the term order. Order means the formal expression of any decision of civil court. Even while understanding decree, we had the same terminology. Even the decree was a formal expression of a decision of the civil court. But here, while going through the definition which is in relation to order, we found that it is also a formal expression of any decision of civil court, but it is not a decree. It means there is somewhat a thin line difference between decree and order. It is a formal expression in contradiction to decree and judgment. If we take into consideration second point, it is again a depth study which says that order is definitely a formal expression, but it is not that which is that in decree or a judgment. Means there is a difference. Order is different from decree and judgment. Now, order follows judgment. All the time, first the order is passed, later on the judgment is made, and later on again the decree is made. So, first order is the first order among three is first order, that is to say section 214, then the judgment, that is section 2 clause 9. And then the section 2 clause 2, first order, second judgment, third is decree. Now order directs the party to do something or refrain from doing something, but does not finally determine the right of the parties. Now this is again very important. Now let us understand by taking into consideration a situation. I filed a suit against you, and you being a defendant in the matter appear before the court. When you appear before the court, I ask for my lord, he has done so and so, and therefore an injunction need to be, I want to obtain an injunction against this particular person. Now injunction means what? Injunction is nothing but an order of the court directing a party to do something or not to do something. Here, if the court, on the basis of my submission, if prohibits you from doing something or if direct you to do something, then in that case, it would be considered to be an order, right? So, order directs the party to do something or refrain from doing something. But you've been only directed to refrain or to do something, but you've been not actually stopped permanently. It means whenever a stay is obtained against the other party, there are certain things on the basis of which the stay is granted. There are certain grounds on the basis of which the stay is granted. But in the future time, during the pendency of that litigation, if suppose that particular ground do not exist, then in that case, whether that particular stay would be continued one or would be vacated, it would be definitely vacated. So the order which was passed by the court directing a party to do something or refrain from doing something was nothing but an order which not conclusively or finally has determined the right of the parties, but could be later on any time vacated by proving that the grounds on which that order was passed at present do not exist. And hence, because the grounds at present do not exist, the order which was passed in the early time do not have any sense to be continued today. And hence, the order need to be vacated. So, order directs the party to do something or to refrain from doing something, but does not finally determine the right of the parties. Finally, determination of the right of parties is done under which? Is done under decree. That is what we have seen when we dealt with the definition of the term decree. Now, after passing of order, the suit does not come to an end. Except in certain cases. Suppose if we are only asking one thing, definitely one order is going to dispose of our suit. But we are asking n number of things. Then in that case, one by one, one by one, one by one, court is deciding the things. So, if suppose court has decided one issue, rest other issues are still remaining, right? So, only after passing an order, the suit does not get completely disposed of, provided there is an exceptional situation. Like order in an competent proceeding, contempt proceedings is a judgment and not an order as defined in the court. Suppose, for example, ke taur pe we have filed a contempt suit against or contempt proceeding against you. So we'll be asking only one remedy. So whatever the judgment is given, in that case, it would be termed to be an order and conclusively determining the suit between the parties, conclusively determining whether the contempt has taken place or not. But it is not so when we take into consideration the definition of the term order which has been provided under the code. Because definition of the order which provided under the code speaks about that it do not finally determine the real dispute between the parties. And in the contempt proceeding, only one issue is there, that contempt has taken place. Once that particular issue has been decided, then in that case, that particular order does not cannot be called to be an order, but would be called to be a judgment, because they are completely disposing of the matter and on the basis of which the decree could be drawn accordingly. Here, if we want to understand the order within the purview of CPC, we must keep it in mind two things. Firstly, order simply is going to direct a party to do something or not to do something. But in certain situation, definitely there are exceptions to it. That is to say, if only one issue is involved, but we have to keep it in mind that so far as order which is defined under CPC is that do not completely dispose of the matter, and hence the order which we consider the same to be a final order, or the order which we are considering the order which is conclusively determining the matter between the parties, would not be considered to be an order under CPC. So, for considering the definition of the term order under CPC, what is important is the order would be a formal expression of any decision of the civil court, but would not be termed to be a decree. Why it would not be termed to be a decree? Because it is not going to finally determine the right of the parties. Now, come to next point, that is, an order cannot be preliminary or final. It is always a final one. So, we knew that decree is a preliminary or a final. Why decree is preliminary? Because in between something is decided and something is left over. Because something is left over, we cannot say that the decree is finally given. So, unless and until everything is completely disposed of, no final decree could be passed. But order jo hai cannot be preliminary or final. It always need to be a final one. Now, students, let us see the difference between the judgment, the decree, and the order. Now, what do we, if we take into consideration the difference, then in that case, we would see that judgment has been provided under section 2, clause 9. The decree has been provided under section 2, clause 2. The order has been provided under section 2, clause 14. Now, judgment, section 2, clause 9. Now, we'll be actually considering whatever we have studied till yet. And nothing new in it. We'll be covering the every aspect as soon as we can, so that we would be in a position to understand the three difference in a very particular manner. First, judgment. It is a statement given by the judge on the ground of a decree or an order. What does the decree mean? It is a formal expression of adjudication conclusively determining the right of the parties relating to all or any of the matter in controversy. If we take into consideration the definition of the order, it is nothing but a formal expression of any decision of a civil court, and it's not a decree. Judgment, it is a declaration by a judge of his intention as to the final result of a suit. It is based on reasoning and it's kind of a prelude of a decree or the order. Decree is a final result of suit, it follows judgment. Order is a decision of the court, it follows judgment. Now, if we take into consideration the judgment, then it contains a concise statement of case, point of determination and decision and reason for the same. So far as decree is concerned, it declares the outcome of suit and conclusively determines the right of the parties. If we take into consideration order, order directs the party to do something or refrain a party from doing something and do not finally determine their right. Judgment is not a formal expression, but decree and order are formal expression. Judgment states the ground of decree or the order. Decree is conclusively determining the right of parties. Order do not finally determine the right of parties. So far as judgment is concerned, it leads to final disposal of the suit after a decree is drawn up or an order is passed. Decree, after passing a decree, the suit is disposed of as a right of parties are finally determined. So far as order are concerned, after order, the suit does not come to an end except in certain cases. The last point, the judgment is, it may result into preliminary decree or a final decree or an order. By itself, the judgment is always final. Now, decree, it may be either preliminary or final, and the order, it is always a final one. So, students, I hope you have understood the difference between judgment, decree and order. We have today dealt with what do we mean by the term order. We have similarly dealt with what do we mean by the term judgment, its various kinds, its binding effect, its nature, and yes, what are the examples which would be given in order to understand these particular terminologies. I hope you have understood the things clearly. If there is any doubt, you may physically come to me. I would love to answer your queries. And if there is any doubt, you may put the query in the box also. And I hope you have understood the topic. I'll stop the meeting now. And
hello, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am. Hello.
Yes.
Ma'am, can you share?